trusted us. It means like, I give you your freedom. It's up to you. Holy Ghost for me is literal. I take it literally when it says in the Bible, whenever the two of you are there, I will be there. I am there. It means the gift of freedom. It means God doesn't want to play that up there a guarantee. It means God entrusts the fate of creation, his own fate, into us. It means what happens here is part, as it were, of the history of God. And although I don't agree with Amalo and Levinas, he made nicely this point, here I agree with him, apropos iconoclasm. Don't misread it. The prohibition to make image of God in Judaism does not mean, oh, this Gnostic way, oh, it's too mysterious, we cannot paint it. It means exact opposite. It means God is alive, not in your stupid deep meditations of up there, but how you act, react with others. That's why you shouldn't make images, because it's not an image to be made up there. And I think, if anything, even more, this holds for Christianity. That's for me what Holy Ghost is. God is no longer the substantial master up there. God is, to put it in this way, the spirit of our community. It's the gift of freedom. I claim, if you don't draw this crazy conclusion, then whatever you claim to be, you repaganize Christianity. You fall back at that level of God is up there sending messengers or whatever. Sorry, but to inform you, although you know this, but Christ is not a messenger of God. Christ is God. I'm just trying to draw conclusions from what this means. I'm sorry if I was too long. On the other hand, I'm not sorry. You had to suffer it. That's life. Thanks very much. We can do some 20 minutes, we'll see, no? But maybe we should be a little bit liberal, and those who want to leave, let them out. No.
We have some time for questions, and what we thought we'd do so that everyone can hear is we have a couple of microphones here and here. And so if you have a question pertaining to what was discussed and presented, you can cue up to the mic. If you, Zizek said we should be a little bit liberal and allow those who would like to end their suffering to leave now, so.
Yeah, liberal, but did you see Goldfinger, James Bond? You remember that car where you press the button, no? My dream is to have here this kind of a plan. You ask me a nasty question, I press the button, you jump up, and nonetheless.
Well, since we don't have the button, or maybe we do, I don't know. So if you feel like you'd like to leave, feel free. Otherwise, go ahead and we'll try to negotiate back and forth between the two. Do you want to do, or should I?
There is a guy there already.
Are we ready? Okay. So Zizek, if you will comment briefly, maybe on the connection between what you were talking about earlier and some of your other work and your writings. Maybe something about how in films like Independence Day, where we saw the events that would later happen, and then we look at movies like the two you mentioned today, where we didn't see what we knew happened.
Sorry, which is the second film? I didn't get it.
The two you discussed earlier, the two, the Flight 9... And, and the relationship between the Desert Storm conflict, where we watched the film or the war on television as if it were a film or we were experiencing it, and the current conflict where we dismiss it with media and just kind of talk about it from the point of view of DC.
There are so many. Again, I will be short because it's... I hate you because it's too good question in the sense to... I mean, to, you know what I mean? To answer it properly, it's, again, half an hour and so on. No? What I want to say is that first, when you said, like, Independence Day, we saw what happens later, no? My God, many people accused me when I wrote about this in my Welcome to the Desert, as if I'm some kind of a mean, evil, anti-American and wants to say, you see, you were dreaming about it, so you basically got what you not only desired, no? Here things are much more complex, because, you know, the first lesson of psychoanalysis is that It's also, I think, the title of that last novel of Truman Capote, Unfinished, something along these lines. Namely that, you know, the worst thing that can happen to you is that your dreams come true, how should I put it, no? The Freudian notion of desire is much more complex. If you fantasize about something, it is often that the worst thing that can happen is if this fantasy is brutally from outside imposed onto you. In one of my books, I even make a very unpleasant, I take a brutal example, but talking with many feminists who first were shocked, but then half accepted it, I'm convinced in the truth. Namely, you know, now this will be problematic for some of you, but at least listen to the end. Do you remember this usual phrase of a rapist, no? Oh, but she secretly deserved it. I only gave the bitch what she really was asking for. Now, the standard defense is, oh, male fantasy, they dream about it, and so on. But when they speak frankly, many women will tell you, I read many minutes of reports on rape, that it is true that there was some kind of desire. Now comes my conclusion. Does this justify it? Not. It's even more horrible. What do I mean by this? I read in my country some reports on rape, and one thing is clear. I do it in one of my early books. Imagine this situation, just to get the point. Of course, it's not as simple as that, but the basic point is like this. Imagine two women, to simplify to the utmost. One is self-assertive, autonomous. The other is more passive, dreams about being beaten, raped, and so on. Imagine both of them raped. I claim for the second one, it would have been much more terrifying. The first one will get over, maybe, I hope so, take even some revenge afterwards. For the second one, who, at a certain level you can say, oh, she just got what she was dreaming about, for that one I fear she may kill herself, and so on, I claim afterwards. That is to say, there is nothing more humiliating than to get from the outside, like stuck into your face, the fact of your dreams, because you know fantasies are a very fragile thing. So back to that point, I think this is a different question, but very interesting one. Why this eternal fascination of the United States with the victory of the enemy from all those fantasies, and I like them, you know, all those stories where there was, I think, with, I don't know who played in it, a big miniseries some 10, 20 years ago where Soviet Union occupied the United States and then daily life, and even the last one, I bought it, my God, at the airport now 4 days ago. I forgot some Italian-sounding author, Prayers for the Assassins. The idea is atomic bombs, blah, 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 war, the result, United States falls apart. Southeast, Bible Belt Republic, New York, that area, atomic waste, and LA, Northwest, in Seattle, Islamic Republic of the United States, no? And it's a very nice novel because it doesn't paint Islamists simply as bad. It tries to imagine how it would have fun. But again, the point is, what ideological pleasure do you get from it, no? So, okay, I would have to go on too much, but to go your other points about where we get, we didn't see, and so on. I'm not, no, I will make another point here, and that's all I can say now. I am not saying, maybe I gave a wrong impression, that the true film would have been the one which would have provided a total picture with all historical causes of the events. No, I already hinted a couple of versions of what would have been a more truthful film. For example, as I said, American 11 instead of United 93. That is to say, not some kind of Marxist optimistic total knowledge, but at least the true despair, how should I put it, no? At least the true despair. And again, this doesn't involve any kind of secret pseudo-leftist justification. Ha-ha, you got what you want, or whatever. No, It's just, how should I put it, the problem is simply precisely to confront things in all their horror. What bothers me in this aggressive, either here, Republican attitude, it's a feature which somehow strangely, this idea that you can only tell the story when people fight back. And no, you know that this was the same in communist countries. It's a strange thing why, when they were dealing with those who survived the concentration camps, the communist regimes always found it a kind of a irrational hatred and guilt. Usually all those Russian soldiers who were freed from Nazi camps, most of them were sent to Siberia, killed, or even worse, in my country, Slovenia, part of ex-Yugoslavia, we avoided Stalinist show trials, but there was one show trial monstrous in 50-51. It was called Dachau trial. The survivors of Dachau were put to trial, accused of surviving Dachau because they collaborated with the Germans and that they are now English spies, the usual story. But what fascinated, I think what is beneath is that the communists couldn't imagine this true despair, that there are situations where you can be so humiliated that it's no longer possible, this heroic stance, shoot, but I fight back, and so on. No, they still, it's somehow too embarrassing, unimaginable to them, this utter despair embodied in the figure of this, nicely described in Agamben's book about Auschwitz, these Muslims, Musulmen, and this living dead, totally broken. Or to put it in another way, it's a very sensitive topic, but I insist on it. Did you notice a strange fact that most of the really good films about Holocaust and so on are comedies? I think there is a deeper necessity into it, in it. What kind of necessity? Tragedy can only be written, something can be staged, presented as tragedy when things are not really truly desperate to the end. Because in tragedy, you retain a minimum of dignity to play your tragic role with this heroic dignity. So to a film which would have taken place, for example, in Auschwitz as a tragedy would have been an obscenity, I claim. It would have given too much credit to the Nazis. The whole point is that there the terror was so total that it was not possible to do a conflict at the level of tragedy, which is why, and which is why some of the scenes, if you read Primo Levi, the way he describes the